Welcome to Past and Presents. This is our last episode of the season, so to speak. And as you can kind of tell from my surroundings, this is our special episode. This is our road trip episode. Ever since we came up with the idea of kind of fusing past and presents and making location a really important part of the webisode series, we thought that we should have something to kind of symbolize the notion of history as a journey. We talked about the past as a foreign country, which implies travel and movement. But what better way to underscore that before we go for the semester than to actually go to a place and maybe to shoot a few clips along the way. So we're on our way on I-35 North, headed to the city of Duluth on the shores of Lake Superior. We'll stop a couple of places along the way and then show you a couple of sites in Duluth once we get there before we wrap up the semester in this first season of Past and Presents. Made our first stop on our road trip episode of Past and Presents. We're just outside Pine City, Minnesota. This is a little over an hour north of the Twin Cities off the interstate, and we're into the woods here off the Snake River at the Northwest Company Fur Trade Post. This is one of 26 sites around the state administered by the Minnesota Historical Society, so it's not just the History Center in Fort Snelling, it's sites around the state. And so this is a post that's a kind of living history site set in the year 1804. So over 50 years before Minnesota became a state, when this is still a territory, this is still the frontier. This is a site where European traders, British and French, and Native Americans, the Ojibwe in particular, met to exchange goods, to exchange furs. And so we're standing here overlooking the post itself, a kind of wooden fort structure they've reconstructed. And then there's also an Ojibwe encampment just a little way down the trail. Just wanted to show you this, partly to give you a sense of how the classroom can expand beyond Bethel, beyond the Twin Cities, into the state of Minnesota. We've had students do papers, for example, from Fort Ripley, have gone up and done military history. So as you continue to think about internships or research opportunities, do cast your gaze a little bit beyond the Twin Cities itself. Okay, we'll keep going on our road trip. We'll stop in Hinckley next. But first, why don't we pick up our faculty conversation for this week. So Amy and AnneMarie, most of the students taking this class are probably in their first year, their second semester of college life. At this point, how much should they be thinking about things like career or vocation? What would be maybe some appropriate first steps as they look beyond even college life?
I will jump in on this one because I have very strong feelings about vocation and career. I think students should be thinking about their vocation, but I think vocation is different from career, and I know that's something we might talk about a little bit more later, but you know, we are at a Christian institution, and not everybody who comes here is Christian. But so in the sort of Christian setting, vocation is a calling, and for me, that's what God is calling you to do. And I think a liberal arts Christian education is the best place to explore what it is that God is calling you to do, because you actually have the opportunity to take a lot of different kinds of courses, including those in science. You came here thinking you were going to be a history major, and it turns out you love biology because you had to take this course. Mm-hmm. Is that God speaking to you? Is that God asking you to think about maybe your gift is here, maybe there's a calling there? So I think they should be thinking about their calling always, but I don't think they should be worried about what am I going to do to make a living after college, because I think that will come later.
And I think that is, I mean, I really like what you said, because I think that it's the idea of not answering the question of what am I supposed to do, but who am I supposed to be?
Yeah.
Which is something that we talk about a lot here at Bethel, I think. And so something that I feel like that we have worked on as a department in the last few years, and that I feel like we are getting better and better at it, is helping students be equipped to, again, not think specifically about what are you going to do, but mm-hmm. rather who are you, what skills do you have, and how do we create sort of a seamlessness for you between hard skills and who you are, and that who you are contributes to those hard skills, and those hard skills help develop who you are as a person. So I think that that's something that's particularly important to think about, because I think that the more consciously you are thinking about that, then the better you're going to be at articulating that, whether it's to, you know, family and friends who say, what are you doing with a history major, or whether it is when you're looking at internships or future employers, that we're just as interested in who you are becoming, and that's directly tied. It's not independent from the actual skills that you're obtaining.
Well, let's talk about calling. We can come back to career maybe more specifically later on. I love what you're saying. I also know it's hard to hear the calling.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, one thing I talk with first year student, you're surrounded by voices, right?
Yes.
And not all of those are voices you ought to be listening to.
No.
And some that you shouldn't be listening to might be parents saying, here's what you ought to do with your life.
Yeah.
It might be pastors. Yeah. It might be me, right? I might not actually know you.
Right.
You might not know you.
Right.
So, I mean, either maybe from your own personal experience, I don't know if you feel like you've got a kind of a call or moments of call, or like what advice do you offer students of how do you filter out the other voices and listen for the one that actually is doing that calling in their life?
I would say, you know, one thing that I've seen from students is they are reluctant to try lots of different kinds of things because they're concerned about failing. To me, failing gives you indications about what maybe you ought not to do, or how badly do you want it? Is that then an indication? Kevin Craig, a former history professor here, once told me that, you know, God sometimes calls you to what you love. And sometimes experiencing something and having great passion for it is an indication that you need to pursue that. And then maybe the door gets closed later on, but at least you have been faithful in pursuing it and responding to that. I think it also helps you be more creative about what you think about doing and applying for. And so as you're looking for classes and internships, okay, that doesn't seem to fit maybe with your history major, but, you know, is there a way in that, is there a way in which working for the Twins organization, because you have such a love for this, does actually tie back into it in some way?
No, I agree with that 100%. I think that, one, on the first thing that you said, just about not having a fear of failure, and the idea that you have to try for things and trying for things and building, you know, part of building virtue and building integrity is trying for things that you don't just know you're going to get.
Right.
It's shooting higher and it's just going through that experience.
And it will hurt to fail.
Mm-hmm. It will hurt, you know, and I think that that's something that our culture has lost a little bit of that value of the value of failure and of having to make new plans. And I think what that teaches you then is kind of goes to your other idea about the fact that, you know, calling isn't one specific thing. And I think, again, that's we have to kind of take the time to do the hard work of saying when you're called, we're not saying that you're called to one particular job.
Right.
Maybe you will be. I don't know. But calling is something that's about, if you were to look at the seven different things you're interested in, can you find a common denominator between them?
Right.
You know, and so I think that that's one of the things, again, about our department that is great, is that, well, everyone feels compelled and is gifted in particular different areas related to the academic work they're doing. I think everyone actually feels very called to be a teacher.
Yeah.
And it may not be teaching specifically, like it has to be at this level, but it's that idea of what happens when we're teaching and working with others. And so to kind of help students think about, again, like what's the common denominator when you look at all of the different types of things that you enjoy? Because we are very hyper-focused on one career, one path, and that's not, I think we want you to confidently think differently than that.
Johnny, get your gun. Take it on the run. Hear them calling you and me, every son of liberty. Hurry right away, no delay, go today. Make your daddy glad to have had such a lad. Tell your sweetheart not to pine, we'll be proud her boys in line. Over there, send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the drums from coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer, send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there. Johnny, get your gun. Johnny, show the hun you're a son of a gun. hoist the flag and let her fly. Yankee Doodle, do or die. Pack your little kit, show your grit, do your bit. Yankees to the ranks, from the towns and the tanks. Make your mother proud of you, and the old red, white, and blue. Over there, over there. Send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drum, drum coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word, who'll be where. We'll be over, we're coming over. And we won't come back till it's over, over there.
We're about halfway on our road trip to Duluth. We've stopped in Hinckley, Minnesota, home of world-famous Toby's Restaurant. We'll be getting some gas and a calma roll later. This is also the home of the Great Fire of 1894, however. Hinckley, in the late 19th century, was the center of pine tree logging, and there'd been a drought all summer. And on September 1st, it exploded into a massive conflagration. Temperatures got up to 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit. Several hundred people died. There's a museum here if you're interested in the Great Hinckley Fire. Probably its most famous victim, we think, was a guy named Boston Corbett, better known as the Union soldier who shot John Wilkes Booth during the manhunt following Lincoln's assassination. We're going to come back to our road trip, but why don't we throw it back to our alumni interview for this week.
I am a Bethel graduate, 1988.
I'm a 1999 Bethel grad.
I'm a teacher at Minnehaha Academy.
I am the pastor of worship and adult ministries here at Church of the Cross.
Mutuality editor and publications coordinator.
I work as an attorney in the business and corporate practice.
English Language Institute, China, in China.
Library director at the College of St. Scholastica.
I'm a history professor at Bethel University.
I was a history major.
I was a Bethel history major.
I was a history major.
I was a history major.
I was a history major.
History major.
I was a history major.
I was a history major.
I'm Tony Barthel. I'm a 1999 Bethel grad, a history major, and a political science major, so I was a double major. I work as an attorney in the business and corporate practice at Howell & Habeck in Minneapolis. Going into being a history major, I didn't really know what to expect other than I really liked to study it. And so I was a business major for my first semester, and I took business calculus, and I knew that that just wasn't fulfilling for me. And so I sat down with Neil Lettinga, and he pulled out the list of the 105 things you can do with a history major. And I just thought, well, there's still choices, and so I might as well study something that I enjoy. And so I did. And I knew right away, once I started those classes, that I enjoyed every minute of it. I enjoyed the material. I enjoyed the professors. And I'd have to say that what sealed it was we had a World War I class during interim, and I just so thoroughly enjoyed it. And I saw people from outside the major enjoying it, and I thought, I'm really lucky that every day this is my experience as a history major. I get to do this all the time. And that's when I knew that that was a lot of fun for me. I was a TA for Ruben Rivera and also Diana Magnuson. And so I had Ruben Rivera his first year. One of the projects that I worked on was we were looking for rare books for his collection to do some works for his dissertation. And so I perused all the used bookshops around town, made phone calls, and tried to source materials. So that was a lot of fun. And then I worked with Diana Magnuson for 1 year. And one of my jobs there was getting the archives started over at the seminary. And so I walked into a room that would just had books and pictures and everything you can possibly imagine that was just stuffed in the corner, and start sorting through and trying to bring some organization to it. And so it was a lot of fun because it was opening boxes of, well, what's in here? And so I had to kind of try to guess by decade and start sorting through it that way. So that was a fun project. I enjoyed it, and it was a little bit unique TA experience, I think. Well, I was a poli-sci minor at first. So really, for lack of anything else other than G.W. Carlson was around, and it was either a history course or a poli-sci course, and they were all interesting me, so I just kept taking those courses. And I finished a semester out in Washington, D.C., and came back and realized I'm within 3 credits of having a political science major. And so then, kind of as an afterthought, we developed a kind of a way through to get the major. So I had to double up on a couple things in my senior year, but I was able to get that too. So at first I was a history major and a poli-sci major by happenstance, but they were both fantastic, and they both spoke to each other very well. I think it's an invaluable experience. I would suggest anyone that has the opportunity to be able to go away for a semester do that, particularly when you're a Bethel student. You get used to a rhythm and a routine, and it's very comfortable. And it's not so much that I want someone to become uncomfortable, but there is another perspective. And I remember coming back very disillusioned, which wasn't a bad thing. It was an exposure to something that was bigger than what I had experienced up to that point. And so I had to develop the skill of reintegrating into something that was different. I enjoyed my time at American Studies program. It was a lot of fun. Got to meet some great kids from across the country, from different CCCU colleges and universities, and had people come visit from school, so that was fantastic. And then got to go to practically every building in the city. In fact, I even got to go in the Oval Office one night for dinner, which was not a planned event, it just kind of happened. And so in the State Building, Supreme Court, just to see where some of this was going on, and being a poli-sci and a history person, it was a constant field trip. There was always something going on, or was recognizing someone down the street, and it made that which was theoretical and that which was somewhat abstract to something very real, and you saw how everything worked together. And so for me, it kind of gelled what was going on into there's something that is going on here. And some of the skill sets started to show up too. Part of it was pulling together massive amounts of information, developing themes, reading through materials, finding things that don't fit, and kind of letting that part of the research die. So from a research perspective, that program was invaluable for me, and I really enjoyed it. So when I went to DC and was able to observe the town in general, it's pretty hard to notice that most everyone has some legal training in various offices. So there's lots of people that don't, but every office is touched by lawyers in some way. And I saw that and I detested it. I didn't want it. I was very disillusioned with the idea that somehow this fight was always going on and there was conflict. And for me, that conflict was something I wasn't used to experiencing. And the fight and the competition for ideas was very real. And so that embodied, that lawyerly approach embodied that competition that I didn't want to embrace. And so when I came back, I knew for sure, 100%, I would never be a lawyer, ever. But I wasn't sure exactly what I wanted to do. Lost in some way. I knew that I had some capabilities. I could read, I could write, I could do some research, I could facilitate meetings with people, but I didn't have a place. And one of the things I looked at was going to Cornell University in New York to be a city planner. And so I started studying for the GRE and all sorts of other things, and came to the conclusion that that just wasn't really me. It was just trying to fill something. And so it was really hard transition for me out of school. I didn't really have a lot of direction. But I did have one friend that had gone to the University of Minnesota Law School for a year. And so I decided that I would not let lawyer jokes keep me from at least looking at it. And so I talked to her about it. And when I started hearing about the experience and what you do as a law student, I thought that that sounded like what I was made to do. And so I looked into it. And some of those things were reading. I loved to read. I could just devour a book. Part of it was presenting a case, finding some things that fit, things that don't fit. So some of the reasoning that goes on in that process. And the cause effect of things, also out of a history major. You know, this happened and this caused this and it's natural. This is what we would try to do because of what happened. And so I thought that was a very natural fit for me to check out. And so when I got to law school, what I found out was there's a lot of really smart kids. And it was really, not imposing, but it was weighty, I guess, in some way, where everyone was from different backgrounds, not all history majors, but there were plenty of them, but they were also all pretty much supercharged. And so that was unique, and that was the part that I had a really hard time with, was the hyper-competitiveness of the situation. And then so what I had to do was I had to say, you know, I'm not going to compete with these people. I'm going to compete with myself. And that really for me was the change. And I looked at my skills and ability and what I like to do, and it no longer became what other people expected me to do or how I fit into someone else's system, but what was I naturally gifted at. And so when I looked at the history major and then what also lawyers do, there's a host of things that we do as lawyers that tend to attract people from English majors, poli-sci majors, history majors, and you do get business and finance folks. But one of the legs up, I think, particularly early on as a student, is you can devour massive amounts of information. And that's really what it turned into, was who can sit in the chair the longest and get through the most material and remember some of it. And so it was never a memorization. It was taking information in and try to develop themes. And so that's another thing that showed up in the history major, was what are the themes? Why did something happen? What's the cause and effect? What seems to be natural? What is a person's normal response to something based on the situation? And so for me, that was really powerful to be able to show up with that skill set and start sorting through relationships, characters, you know, who the parties are, and what should probably happen, and then how did it get diverted a bit. So that was good for me. I think also same thing goes for young lawyers. You walk in and you've been to law school for 3 years and you don't know anything. Literally, you would think that you'd show up and you're newly minted and you can do all these great things, and you show up that and realize that you don't know where to get anything, you don't know where to find anything. And so it's kind of the process of finding research again and finding resources, and how can you shorten the cycle to get down to the white hot center of the issue as fast as possible. In law school, you had as much time as you could stay awake for. And when you got into practice, it was, well, how much will clients pay you for? And so you only had so much time to get it done. So finding some of those research skills really came back well for me, because senior STEM's perfect example. You have to write a thematic paper. How do you go through all the materials and sort through what your theme is? How do you support it? We have to do that in law every day. What supports it? Where do I get that? And then also all the relationships that go into understanding which parties belong where. So I think there's a contextual advantage that you get from that major that really is helpful, particularly early on as an associate, because like we were discussing before, learning how to learn, learning how to learn something you don't know, is really one of the hallmarks of lawyers. We don't walk out the door and know how to do really anything. But what we do learn how to do is go solve problems, and that's what we spend our time doing. And so if it was easy, the person would probably go solve the problem for themselves, but what we bring is a different skill set to solve problems. So number one for me, which is it's non-academic, was I spent a lot of time in my studies. I probably would not spend as much time in my studies, and I would have focused more on relationships. And it's not that I didn't have them, I did. It's you know, when it was Friday night at 11 o'clock, I might still be studying, and my friends were probably doing something fun. So, and that's more effective once you're outside of school. And so that was, I wouldn't say a struggle for me, but it was something that I wish that I could go back and do a bit. I probably would have taken a couple more other courses to get a little bit more variety. But I really was able to supplement that with just the interest in reading different things. And so it's tough to, I mean, I don't know that I would go back and do it over, but if I was sitting down with someone, I'd say take courses that are diverse and don't buy into the demand that people are placing on you that you specialize as an 18-year-old. I've heard that now. I've been practicing law for 12 years, and from day one, I've heard specialize. And as I get into my practice, and my practice is a general corporate counsel role, the more diverse, the more liberal arts approach I take to my job, the more breadth and depth I can bring, because I serve more as a quarterback than as a specialist. And so I know where to go find answers. I know where to go find people. I know how to solve problems and situations that I wouldn't if I was very narrow in my focus. And so if you choose to be a history major, one of the choices that you're making is you're choosing, in some part, to be a generalist. And so embrace that. Rather than view that as something that's a negative, embrace it for what it is and become very broad in your skills, abilities, interests, and you'll relate to people better. I think that's probably one thing I would tell a student. Another one is, your folks might say, what can you do with a history major? The reality is, what I've seen over and over is some of the very best, the most talented people I see in business are people that came out of liberal arts backgrounds. They didn't walk out and have their job ready in hand. And so that's one of the downsides, is it is very competitive up front. But the difference is, you will learn how to do your jobs, and it also forces you to broaden your horizons a bit, to take into account all the different pieces. So it's not, you don't get your ticket punched when you have a history major. We all know that. There's no surprise. And for me, that's why law school made sense. At the same point, I think 10 years down the road, 20 years down the road, how it serves you and your ability to learn, ability to deal with people is invaluable. And lots of people I see in leadership positions have that ability, and not just a singular focus in one specific discipline.
I looked for an internship just to kind of give me some more views of like different areas and aspects of museums, and just even looking at living history versus like the Minnesota Historical Society, and seeing just if there was an area that I could find my niche in, or just things I was passionate about that I didn't realize. And so I ended up working with Item Homestead, which is a living history museum. It's set on a farm between 1890 and 1910. Which I chose that one. There were a very few various ones. I could be working with an archives at the downtown Central Library and their special collections, but this one just was more appealing just because it was something I hadn't encountered, and I thought it was good to explore that a bit too. I loved the staff, and so getting ready for our Spring on the Farm event was just really fun, even though, just planning everything from the Doug Oman photo presentation of his historic farm or his historic barns, but also just planting like flowers and planting herbs for the kids, and just very tangible physical tasks I was given. I really like that, and having deadlines and meeting those, but just getting to work on that with the staff there was really enjoyable.
We've arrived in Duluth, Minnesota, and we're in what's called the Civic Center District in downtown Duluth. I'm standing in front of the Soldier and Sailors Monument. This dates to 1921, so kind of in the wake of World War I, but actually for the 60th anniversary of the American Civil War. So if you look at the names inscribed on the monument, these were surviving veterans in 1921 from Duluth and Greater St. Louis County. It's a really interesting memorial. It's a lot more nakedly patriotic than a lot of memorials from the 1920s. In fact, the statue that I'm standing in front of is called Patriotism Guards the Flag. It was designed by Paul Whelan Campbell, who's an architect who also worked on the U.S. House of Representatives in Washington, D.C. The rest of the memorial is by Cass Gilbert, who did Minnesota State Capitol, which many of you have seen before. We mention this partly because it's the middle of this kind of neoclassical district. The U.S. Courthouse is over there, the St. Louis County Courthouse, so it's kind of the center of politics and law in Duluth. At a time in the 1920s when Duluth was really positioning itself to be a kind of international city, you know, this port city connected to Canada with Lake Superior, but really something bigger than St. Paul and Minneapolis, actually. So it's part of the City Beautiful movement, and they chose neoclassical architecture to emphasize the power and the stature and the permanence of Duluth. The population of St. Louis County has actually diminished since 1920, and Duluth never did really achieve that status, although it's certainly still a very interesting city on lots of counts. So we'll look at one more site in Duluth before we say goodbye for this episode and for this semester, but let's pick up our last faculty conversation.
So we talked some about vocation and calling. I do want to come back to career, because
sure.
I hear everything you're saying. I also know students, or at least their parents,
yep,
are concerned, and I feel like I always struggle, right? Because my answer to what do you do with a history major is you can do anything with a history major because of all the things you just said, because we equip you with all these skills. At the same time, it's nice to tell at least stories of here is some kind of unexpected, out-of-the-box things history majors have. Do you have a favorite story? Maybe it's your own story. Maybe it's a relative. Maybe it's a former student you've had. What's your favorite, like, kind of surprising history major who went? It might even be a kind of predictable career like teaching, but it took a different form or something like that.
Yeah, I guess I can think of one of my closest friends who was a history major at the same time that I was here at Bethel, who did sort of start in a traditional path and started by being a teacher and was a middle school teacher and then a high school teacher, and then found that She was really interested in kind of both the academic and personal counseling sides of what she saw at school, and went on to get her degree in school counseling, and totally felt like being a history major helped her thrive in that context, not only just sort of the skills needed for graduate school, but also her way of thinking holistically and historically about the various sort of issues and things that she was studying, and to understand even things like educational trends, and to sort of see what the trajectory has been over time, and then now has transitioned into working for the State Department. So, you know, here she is on career three. They've all been really good careers, and each one has sort of built on the one prior to it. But the thing linking them together, she would articulate, I think, is the skills that she gained as a history major. And I think that even now, you know, she doesn't necessarily know that that's where she's going to be in 10 years. She has all kinds of options, but they're really all related to her skill set. But she still totally embraces and sees herself as a history major and talks about all of her jobs sort of coming out of that.
I think, too, of Lauren Pefley, who is a graduate of Bethel University, and she was a history major, and I don't know if she had another major or minor, but she ended up working for International Justice Mission after graduating, and now she is pursuing a graduate degree in social work. And I think it was really helpful for her in her work with human trafficking to have that historical background, and then, of course, as she's going into graduate school, having those research skills and things like that, but I think she wants to be someone who's not just an activist at the ground level. She wants to be doing policy changes. And I think, you know, that has been really helpful then to have that academic background as she moves from working at the ground level into then higher level, big change kinds of things.
I think it's really important to put an S on career. I mean, it's actually important. Yep. It's so rare that you're going to have like a 40-year career that's not, I mean, you're going to change, the field is going to change, technology is going to change, the needs of whoever you're serving is going to change. And so I hear this a lot. I mean, it might not be three careers, it might be two, or it might be a shift, but like history majors feel like they've learned how to learn. So they can go back to graduate school. And maybe Lauren didn't think about social work, but she had this, you know, Buechner talks about, you know, deep gladness being a calling. It makes you, it's a love, it's a passion, but also the world's deepest need is a calling too. And maybe she had that sense of need.
Yeah, she did.
And thought, well, I didn't think of this when I was 19, but now that I'm 22 or 23, social work can do this. And she was set up for grad school. One of my favorite stories is Kim Pagelow, who was probably like 3 years before. Lauren, you know, did her senior sem project in like Russian history in the 1930s, and then decided to go back and become a nurse. And did this really, I mean, had to do all the kind of intro level science coursework. Went back, she's a public health nurse, I think. And, you know, we talked to her about it, and there's this kind of sense, well, nurses do history. You know, you've got to interview people and pick out data that fits and explains and discern patterns. But it's also just that she was ready, she was equipped to go back and read a lot and master a lot of material. And so that's an advantage, too, is your career might change. But
I think one of the interesting things about being a history major is that it's risky in the sense that you, the study of history means that you're always opening yourself up to being compelled by something that you're not going to be able to stop thinking about. And that may, well, you know, and that may lead you into doing something different than you had originally planned. Or again, it's planting some seed, you know, thinking about Lauren's work of something that you just cannot let go of. And back to your idea of suffering, it's sort of that idea that you, you know, historians develop this empathy through being exposed to some really awful stuff, but yet that also, you, then you can't ignore it, and then you're responsible for it. And, you know, you, you that might lead you in a different direction, whatever sort of responsibility that you feel for it. So it actually brings a tremendous amount of vulnerability, I think, to study history, because you realize you may stumble upon something that then is going to move your life in a different direction.
Yeah, I don't want to spiritualize these choices too much, but I think there is a degree that majoring in something like history requires some faith, certainly. I mean, it's not, if I do this, I will be then in control of my life. It's a kind of yieldedness, right? To say, I mean, first of all, that I'm much smaller. I mean, if you study history, one thing you should take away is, you know, individuals are very important, but they're also affected by forces well beyond their control and structures. And I think you learn that. And you might kind of push back against that sense that I've got my life mapped out. And when I'm 18, I know exactly the things I've got to jump through in order to get that salary and that office and that kind of lifestyle. And so I would hope that, if nothing else, makes you a little bit more comfortable with the vicissitudes, all the turns you don't expect.
Well, and I think that it's a very, it may be a very, I don't know, I think it's kind of a comforting thing when you stumble upon something and you realize, I care about this, even if no one else thinks this is interesting or no one else does. Now, sometimes that can create a point of connection because what you're reading, you may realize, oh, actually someone else cared about it. Right. You know, and you feel a connection with somebody from the past. But at the same time, I think that it's, that for me is what's comforting about being a historian, is finding something that you just can, you know, you think about dissertation work or things like that, that you find something so compelling that you're just going to continue to care about it, even if nobody else does. And the discipline, I think, rewards that. That's a good thing to do.
Well, and I think it also plays into the notion of a Christian calling. I mean, part of the reason why you take up the tragedy is because you do have hope.
That's right.
That you can be part in some teeny tiny way, even, of the redemptive process.
Right. And part of the redemptive process is, I think, just acknowledging that something needs to be remembered.
Yeah.
You know, even if that nothing's going to change, I think that's a big part of it, is that it's honoring that it happened.
Yeah.
We've come to the end of our journey today on a road trip in Duluth. We're at the tip of Canal Park on Lake Superior. You see Duluth's very famous aerial bridge behind us. Originally, the first bridge was from 1905. The one you see now is from the first year of the Great Depression, actually. You see a lighthouse. You see, I talk about a lot of the features of life here in the harbor in Duluth, what made it such an important economic center, and still is in many ways. This is also the end of our journey for the semester. We do have one more class left for students on Monday night, but this is our last webisode of Past and Presence for this series. Thank you so much for watching, whether you're an alum or someone else checking us out on YouTube or one of the students in Intro to History. It's been fun to take you to different sites around the Twin Cities and the state of Minnesota to remind us of the way the past and present collide in lots of different places, not just in the classroom. So students, enjoy the rest of your studies. Alumni, I hope to see you at lots of different events, and thanks for watching.
Back, baby, back in time.